Hello and welcome to this edition of Peake Life. Today we're talking about a topic that affects lots of people in Chesapeake, and that's bridges. Here to chat about it is Public Works Information Specialist Jason Brown. Jason, thank you for being here.
Thanks, Liz. Always a pleasure.
We have a lot of bridges in Chesapeake, and that's kind of unique for cities around the Commonwealth.
Absolutely. We actually have about 90 bridges in the city of Chesapeake.
Wow.
So if you drive anywhere throughout the city at any time, odds are you're probably going to cross one of these bridges. But most notably, of those 90 bridges, there are six major movable bridges, commonly known as drawbridges, throughout town that odds are, if you're trying to get around from place to place, you've either seen them or you cross it every day.
Okay. Now, are they all ours? You know, there's lots of different ownership of roads and bridges throughout Chesapeake. So are they all Chesapeake's responsibility?
Not at all, actually. Of these six movable bridges in town, only 50% of those are ours, only three.
Okay.
That's the Gilmerton Bridge over on South Military Highway. That's the Great Bridge Bridge on South Battlefield Boulevard and Great Bridge, and the Centerville Turnpike Bridge over on Centerville Turnpike.
Okay.
The other three, the Deep Creek Locks Bridge, which crosses the Dismal Swamp Canal over Moses Grandy Trail, that belongs to the Army Corps of Engineers.
Okay.
There is the North Landing Bridge over on Mount Pleasant Road crossing the Intracoastal Waterway. That also belongs to the Corps of Engineers. And then finally, the bridge that carries the most traffic, it's 73,000 cars a day,
wow,
the responsibility of VDOT, the high-rise bridge on I-64.
So when we're talking about something of that volume going, that amount of cars going over something that is movable, you gotta make that connection that that means a lot of moving parts, which can mean a lot of wear and tear. Tell me a little bit about how often you have to maintain these things, inspections, that kind of stuff. Let's get into the details of keeping these bridges safe.
Absolutely. I mean, just looking at the sheer number of bridges in town, we have got 90 of these, and of those, again, three of those bridges open, and they open every single day multiple times a day.
Yeah.
Like you said, that requires a lot of maintenance and a lot of inspection, and we're uniquely postured here in Chesapeake because of these roads that are movable bridges to maintain those. We have a whole team of public works professionals that monitors, inspects, maintains and repairs these bridges short-term and long-term over time to keep those roadways open to traffic. So we do a really good job here in town. It's something that Chesapeake's kind of become known for and something that we do extremely well. And again, with 188,000 vehicles crossing these bridges every day, we have to have a robust maintenance schedule to keep these bridges operational, and we do that.
And these bridges, I mean, we are a very low flat city, so it's not always an option to have the raised, you know, we've seen the new Veterans Bridge so that the bridges or the boats can go right underneath. But these movable bridges are really essential to kind of save us money in the time being and footprint. You know, tell me a little bit more about why we need specifically the drawbridges.
And the truth is that a lot of these bridges are older. Both the North Landing Bridge and Centerville Turnpike Bridge were built in 1955. The Deep Creek Locks Bridge was built in 1934.
Wow.
So, you know, it's part of the reality that some of these bridges were older. The technology to build large fixed span bridges that cross rivers without having to open simply wasn't available at
the
time.
There weren't that many people.
It wasn't feasible. I mean, it wasn't practical because of the sparse population of Norfolk County and city of Chesapeake at the time. And then you have to consider that, especially when you look at VDOT's high-rise bridge, I mean, these bridges cross expansive waterways. I mean, the Elizabeth River is a wide river, and having a bridge that has to go high enough to cross the river is a major feat of engineering. So you know, we were put into a position where we inherited bridges that are movable bridges, and in some cases, it's more practical to have a small footprint movable bridge that simply opens for maritime traffic and closes to allow vehicular traffic to cross. And as a result, we have maintenance schedules that permit us to keep those bridges operational. Now, with that in mind, as we move forward into the future and as Chesapeake grows as a city and we look ways to improve and expand our infrastructure to keep pace, we look at opportunities through feasibility studies to ensure that our bridges are growing with our roadway system in the city. And you'll see in the coming years that we're exploring opportunities with bridges like the Centerville Turnpike Bridge and with the Army Corps of Engineers down at the North Landing Bridge to look at opportunities to install fixed span bridges that no longer need to open for boat traffic. But in the meantime, the best thing for us to do is to have that robust maintenance schedule that allows those bridges to keep operating, that allows safe passage for both mariners and motorists alike.
So let's talk about those openings, because that's really what everybody wants to hear about. You know, you're trying to leave Great Bridge at 5 o'clock and the Great Bridge opens up for you. how much control do we have over those openings, and why can't we make it so that, you know, motorists get the right of way and motorists get to go where they're going without having to be bothered by a bridge lift?
Yeah, this is always kind of the hard pill to swallow for not only the residents, but for us, you know, as public works professionals. We virtually have no control over when the bridges have to open. You know, federal regulations on, you know, on the behalf of the U.S. Coast Guard and the Army Corps of Engineers mandate that we have to allow maritime traffic to pass through those waterways basically on demand. So we're at the mercy of what those federal regulations dictate. Now, to their credit, the Coast Guard and the Corps of Engineers have worked with us to build what's called restriction periods, wherein maritime traffic has to make a reservation during the most high volume traffic parts of the day. With that said, there are going to be circumstances where boats simply have to pass through those bridges without warning, without any reservation, based on who they are, whether it's a military vessel, it's a vessel carrying hazardous materials.
You don't want that sitting right there waiting for a bridge lift. I mean, let's get that through.
Absolutely. That traffic, and again, military vessels, law enforcement vessels on missions, hazardous materials, these are boats that have to keep moving, not only to keep on schedule, but to keep, you know, surrounding residents, motorists, citizens who are along the waterway safe because of what's in their cargo.
Right.
And fortunately, that doesn't happen terribly often, but when it does, we have to open the bridge to let the boats through. And I know the optics of having a bridge open during rush hour or during peak traffic to let three boats through when you've got potentially hundreds of vehicles in queue waiting. It doesn't look great, but we don't do that by choice. We do that because of federal regulations. And again, we have to give the Coast Guard and the Corps of Engineers credit for allowing us to schedule some of those openings during the day, for example, at the Great Bridge Bridge. We don't open the bridge on demand Monday through Friday from 7 to 6. That opens every hour on the hour. And then the boats will queue up in the locks and pass through kind of all at once. And then the roadway reopens to traffic. And then on the next top of the hour, more boats pass through. And the Coast Guard has allowed us to do that because they understand that these are high volume roadways in a growing city and that keeping traffic moving is important. But again, at the end of the day, there are going to be circumstances where the boats have to pass through, and we just urge motorists passing through, whether they're residents or just passers through, to be patient with us and to bear with us while we get those boats through.
I feel like it's a small price to pay to live in a city that is just full of beautiful waterways, right? I mean, we got to count our blessings where they are.
Absolutely. Chesapeake is beautiful, and it's part of the lifestyle here, living on the shores of the Elizabeth River and here in the Tidewater area. And this just comes with it. We want folks to come through. We want to make sure that everyone is safe. Safety is paramount. And having the ability to let boats through the waterway and keep traffic moving when we can, all that adds up to building what we think is the most efficient use of the roadway and movable bridge system in the city. And we always look for ways to improve that through traffic engineering and through infrastructure improvement. And that's a never-ending process. We are always looking to improve the roadways here in the city in every way that we can.
Now, how can people get warnings about bridge lifts, if at all? How do you do that? What's the best way as a motorist to determine when a bridge might lift, knowing that you can't know all the time because of these last minute lifts?
Absolutely. The first stop we would suggest anybody who lives or passes through Chesapeake to do, if they're curious about these lifts or they cross a roadway that has a movable bridge, is to visit the website, cityofchesapeake.net/bridges. Okay. All the information about all the bridges, including the schedule of what the restriction periods are, when they open, some information about traffic volume, age of the bridge, and important upcoming project information about major road work to these bridges, it's all contained on that website, and we keep that updated with the latest information. Because of the fact that some of these emergency vessels, those military vessels, those hazmat boats that have to come through with no notice, it's really difficult for the city and VDOT and the Corps of Engineers to reliably put information out through social media and websites. 100% of the time. So the best thing that we encourage folks to do is to know when the restriction periods are. Keep an eye on the signage along the roadways, those VMS signs that you see above the roadway, and then follow Chesapeake Roads on Twitter, because we do try during the restricted periods, when we know that a vessel has made a reservation to cross through, we try to put that information out there with at least an hour or two of notice to let motorists know that during a rush hour period, a restriction period, that there's going to be a bridge opening so they can plan ahead for that. We try to do that as often as possible, but again, the reality of the situation is there are going to be situations where the bridge has to open without much warning,
sure,
and traffic is just simply going to have to wait until the bridge closes to get through.
So be patient. If you got to stop, enjoy the scenery. Appreciate the fact that you live by the water.
Absolutely.
And we'll do the best we can.
And know, again, that the city of Chesapeake is always looking at ways to improve this process, to improve traffic volume, flow, roadways, and most importantly, our bridges throughout the city.
Great. Jason Brown, Public Works, thank you so much.
You're welcome, Liz.
That does it for this edition of Peake Life. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next time.